All right, good morning, everyone. I'm going to stop sharing my screen real quick so I can see everybody who is here today. All right, well, good morning to all of our camp and youth professionals here in the state of Wisconsin. Welcome to our third annual summer camp series for day camps from the Wisconsin After School Network. My name is Kelly Coulthard, and I'm a consultant with the Wisconsin After School Network, or WAN. If you like acronyms, I will be facilitating this morning. This is the second of a three-part mini conference that we have been doing. Our first series took place on Tuesday, March 7th, and will be available on WAN's YouTube channel after the series is over. Another consultant assisting me this morning is Dr. Kathy Shader, who is the assistant to the Dean in the College of Professional Studies for Graduate Programs and Outreach at the University of Wisconsin-Stevens Point, as well as assistant director and adjunct faculty for the Educational Sustainability Doctoral Program. She will be joining me today on her way back from seeing the crane migration in Nebraska. And I think she's somewhere in Iowa right now. So she's gonna be popping on with us today a couple of times. Well, the series is further supported by some amazing staff members from the Marshfield Clinic Health System. We have Rachel Sharon, Sarah Bangert, and Jennifer Smith, who we could not do this without them, and also our awesome IT people on the clinic side as well. This summer series wouldn't be possible without financial support from the Wisconsin Department of Children and Families and Marshfield Clinic Health System. A few housekeeping items before we get started. Please keep your microphones on mute. If you have questions, we're gonna ask you to post those in the chat box, which the Marshfield Clinic staff will be monitoring. As a reminder, this presentation is being recorded and will be sent to all registered participants in the next week and posted to the WAN YouTube page. This is our third camp series for day camp and youth professional. This year's theme is focusing on staff recruitment and retention through a wellness lens. 2 weeks ago, we focused on looking at generational differences within our workforce and topics to consider when hiring, communicating, and thinking about wellness within the context of their generational experiences from Dr. Shader and Dr. Bernhagen. Dr. Michaels also spoke about caring for staff in a different world, how to ground yourself and your staff. And finally, we heard from Dr. Scoville, who discussed having tough but crucial conversations with staff and how that relates to our hiring process before, during, and after the camp season. Today is another amazing day, and we're so excited that you're here. Today, we welcome Rachel Sharon, who will be kicking us off today with Stress, a Normal Reaction. She's gonna be looking at reframing stress and reflecting on staff and child experiences of stressors in programming. Then after some Q&A and a break, we will then jump in with Dr. Sally Scoville, who is back for a second day to talk about planning resources for wellness. So coaching tools and toolkits to provide support for well-being of staff. And then again, we will have the same question and then a break time. And then we jump in with Corey Zalowski. If you build it, they will come. And she is an on the ground working with kids in a program. She'll give her all of her credentials because I'm sure I said it wrong. But she has a really great program and a really great way of looking at mental health in the workplace and creating a culture of wellness. And like I said, we'll have time after each one to do some Q&A with our presenters and then move on to that little break in between. But I'm going to kick it off right away because this first session is going to be amazing. I know it will be. Our first session is called Stress, a Normal Reaction. And we are so honored today to have Rachel Sharon, who is a social worker and health educator serving children and families in Wisconsin. She earned her master's in social work from the University of Wisconsin-Madison and worked in the child welfare field as both a direct worker and supervisor for 10 years before transitioning into health education. Rachel has worked in government and private agencies supporting families and staff in a variety of communities across the state. She currently works in direct practice, coaching staff in after-school settings, as well in macro practice for the Wisconsin After School Network. Worker wellness, strengths-based initiatives, and trauma-informed care have been primary focuses of Rachel's work. She completed a 200-hour yoga training program in 2019. Oh, I'm sorry, yoga teacher training. That's very important. Sorry. In 2019, and continues to seek out ways to learn, grow, and promote wellness in others. Thank you, Rachel, for joining us today. And I'm going to turn it on over to you.
Thank you, Kelly. And Kelly has also graciously agreed to be my backup and perform a dance or a song for you all if I start coughing. I'm getting over a cold. See, she's already. I know she won't let us down, but no, I apologize in advance if I have to move for a second, just getting over some illnesses in our family here. So, but hopefully we'll be able to go straight through. I have to say it before I share my slides. I always love hearing other people's bios because I like hearing what they've studied and where they've been and all their experiences. And it's always a little embarrassing to hear your own. But for this presentation, it's a good reminder for me of where I've come from and why I'm here. Because coming from child welfare, where there's been turnover since basically child welfare's inception, that was something that I always spent a lot of time on and cared a lot about and have done a lot of research is keeping workers well, even in tough situations, and really understanding how we can thrive in the moment. And so that's why I'm really excited to be here to talk to all of you because I know there have probably been easier times out in the camp world, and this is a time where we really need to focus on keeping each other well and safe. And so that's what we're gonna talk about today. So thanks for having me. And let's see if I can share successfully here. So I'm gonna pack a lot into today. And so we don't necessarily have a ton of time to do like breakouts or a big discussion as we go, but I'd really like to invite you to all to actively participate by taking the time and the moments that I have planned in here for reflection to do so and really do some of your own work while we go through some of these ideas. And then to also be throwing some of your ideas in the chat, there's going to be some times where I ask you to put some ideas and some things in there. And the more people we have participate in that, I think the more powerful that will be, and the more ideas you will have coming out of this with some concrete strategies to help you and the staff you work with in times of stress. So please participate that way, and then we'll make sure that we save some time at the end for those questions, like Kelly said as well. All right. So just really quickly to give you an idea where we're headed for the next 40, 45 minutes or so is just an overview. What is stress? Where does it come from? Why do we have this? Why do we have stress when it doesn't feel good? There is a biological reason. We're going to talk a little bit about that. And then we're going to reframe it. It's not necessarily a bad thing. And it's actually something that can help us and we can strategize around. And then, like I said, you're going to have opportunities to reflect on how you help staff that you might lead or that you co-lead with. And then we're gonna end with some concrete strategies that you can use going away and hopefully have your own self-care plan and some ideas on how you might start conversations around self-care in your camps as you go forward this year. So to start us off, I want to read over this potential staff scenario. And have this in mind as we go through the next couple of slides. It's a really simple, short one here. So you go out in the field where there's the second and third grade group is transitioning. They're going from an active game to a quieter snack time. You see from afar that several kids are dysregulated and they're having a hard time. However, none of the staff are supporting these particular participants, and one of your staff is completely disengaged, just passively looking at their phone. As kids just kind of rush by. So it's this chaotic scene, and the adults in the room, so to speak, aren't doing a lot. And so you kind of start thinking, like, what is going on here? So, just real quickly, if you want to all use your reaction buttons on the bottom of your screen or the chat, I'm curious to see how many of you have run into a similar situation before. And this might be one of those questions where it's like so obvious. It's like, come on, Rachel, why are you asking us? But I just wanted to start on this similar note to say that we are all having some of these experiences and we're having to navigate what is going on. We're going to look at it from maybe a little different lens than we might initially think to look through. All right, so what we're going to be talking about today is a theory called polyvagal theory, and it's taken from a scientist, Stephen Porges, and a social worker, Deb Dana. And I mention that to cite and give them credit for some of the information that I'm borrowing from them today, but also to give you an idea where you can go for resources after this, because they both have wonderful websites, videos, where you can dive more into this stuff and get into the science behind all of it. But for today, I think it's really important as you all start thinking about your summer camps that we keep things very concrete and what are things that we can actually take away from this theory and use when we go out on the field into a situation like the one we just talked about. So just to go over the basic premise of their theory, the first thing that they talk about is we are all wired to connect, and that feeling disconnected is what actually causes us stress. So that's an important thing to kind of keep in mind as we go forward. The second thing they talk about is that our bodies have an automatic nervous system that responds to keep us safe. And to some extent, our reactions are basically automatic. So sometimes we tend to think that our brains are in control and everything operates up here, when in reality, 80% of signals come from the body up to the brain. And so we have to start understanding that a lot of reactions we have are those automatic ones that happen whether we want them to or not. We make sense or meaning of them later on, but a lot of times our bodies are operating on our behalf without us even knowing. So another important thing to note here is that a person doesn't have to necessarily have a big trauma trigger or a trauma response in order to feel stress. We all have these protective systems designed to warn us and keep us safe. So these are natural reactions. And when we're exposed to repeated stressors, like we very well could be in a stressful day at programming, our bodies can respond similarly to those that have experienced trauma. We can get to that heightened level. And again, it's normal. This is how our bodies keep us safe. All right, I think a lot of people have probably seen an iceberg used as an analogy in one way or another. I know in WAN, we use it when we talk about trauma, and I've seen it when people talk about culture. The idea is that behaviors that you might see or actions or thoughts people have are just one part of a huge, larger story, right? So when we talk about it in terms of trauma, you might see a child really struggling in a certain scenario, and then we dive in and we know that they have this history and these complex traumas that help explain the things that we actually see in front of our faces. So this is also a helpful analogy to better understand what I'm talking about today. And the idea is that similar to emotions, thinking, values that all help explain the behaviors we see, that automatic system that we talked about, that automatic stress system, also plays a role. And I would argue that it's buried even deeper and sometimes even has a bigger impact on those behaviors or those results that we see. So those behaviors that we saw from those staff in that scenario, whether they were on the phone or not engaging with kids, could there potentially be more below the surface that explains some of those behaviors? And just another helpful quote, our body is always doing what it thinks is best for us. So even though that might not align with our job descriptions or what kids need of us, our body is responding to keep us safe. I think it's always helpful here too to remember that most of us aren't really taught like the why, or taught how to think about why someone might be acting the way they are. We're taught to manage behaviors in ourselves, to control situations, to control behaviors in the kids we're working with. And it's really flipping that on its head and really talking about what is the why behind that so that we can change the context and help one another out. Right. Another helpful analogy here is to think of our body in terms of it being almost like a budget. So bear with me here. I know I'm not a fan of numbers myself, but this is really helpful to compare this way. So just like you might subtract money from your bank account to pay for something like a bill or even something fun like a trip to a warm place. I think that's on a lot of our minds right now, getting out of Wisconsin. We have withdrawals to our internal system, right? And it's kind of similar to the withdrawals that we take when we purchase something. But the idea of a body budget and applying this to our nervous systems is especially helpful because we aren't all going to have the same budget to start from. So, for example, $300 taken out of somebody's account that has $200,000 in savings really isn't going to have the same impact on their budget as somebody that doesn't have any savings at all and has to find that $300. Just like a kid screaming maybe in summer camp at a staff member is going to have a different impact on their body budget on somebody that got sleep the night before, had a really great breakfast coming in, has some ideas on how to regulate their nervous system compared to somebody who had a really stressful night, didn't sleep well. You can kind of see how their budget would be depleted a lot quicker than somebody that has that savings account, so to speak. So when we're talking about a body budget and the nervous system, again, those withdrawals are in the form of those feelings, the thoughts, the actions, all of that takes energy away from our budget. And then watching how stable someone's body is can help us understand where their budget might be and how we might help that person or how we might help them think through how to help themselves. So again, this is a good reminder, stress itself isn't a bad thing, but it's a protective thing. And if we know that our body budgets are being depleted, then we know that's time to put some energy back into them, which is what we're going to kind of talk about as we go further here into the day. Another thing that this analogy is helpful for, speaking of the idea that stress itself isn't bad, is that at the thing that really depletes the body budget is when we can't complete our stress cycle. So when we are stressed out, there will be things like cortisol pumping through our bodies or adrenaline. And again, those things are really intended to keep us safe or help us take action and do things that'll help the situation. But if that gets trapped in our bodies, that again kind of takes a toll. And that's when we become depleted and we might have to do something to balance that back out. So on this slide, we have three main pathways with where those withdrawals or those deposits are made on our body budget. So when we're in the green pathway at the top, as you can see, we're essentially feeling safe. We're feeling social and connected to the world around us. So you might think of a staff person in the green pathway as being actively engaged with the kids. They're able to address things as they come up and stay relatively grounded. So this is somebody, for example, they might be able to jump to something new or supervising an age group they don't typically know or work with maybe. They can do that with relative flexibility and ease. So when you're trying to envision this in programming. Whereas if you move down to the red pathway, we're more like a horse or a zebra in the savanna, right, as a visual. So our safety system detects that there's potentially a threat or a challenge. And usually there's some kind of movement in the body. That's where that you can feel that adrenaline, that cortisol kicking in. So there might be like a change in the tone of voice or how someone's interacting with a kid. A staff member experiencing the red pathway is potentially bouncing quickly from thing to thing, or maybe they're quicker to frustration or kind of to shut the conversation down, that kid asking questions, you can kind of imagine. And then as you move down to the blue pathway, when you experience that one, we're completely overwhelmed at that point. We move away from that connection, like we talked about. Stress takes us away from connection. We might seem kind of spacey or drowsy. A staff person in the blue is maybe quicker to send the kids off to like an unstructured activity and kind of sit back and kind of let things happen and not be as engaged with them. So you can see how this would, again, play out in programming. And I think it's all pretty clear that the work we do with kids in summer camp is probably the easiest and even probably feels the most rewarding when we're in that green pathway and we're able to connect, right? We feel the most accomplished when we're able to make deposits and withdrawals to keep us in that green pathway. So again, we might kind of dip into the red or the blue, but it's knowing what are some concrete ways to get ourselves back to that green pathway so that we can operate in that place of connection where we're moving forward side by side, kids, and helping. So right now I'm going to ask you, this is one of those times where I'm going to take a couple moments to reflect and also to use the chat to get your participation and get your thoughts on a little bit of this. So with that staff scenario that we had at the beginning, I'm going to have you think about the body budget and apply that. So with the body budget in mind, what do you think is the status of the budgets of the staff who are just kind of standing back and ignoring those kids that need extra support? And then where do you think the body budget is at of the staff person who is not only standing back, but also engaged in some other activity on their phone? So go ahead and start throwing things in the chat for us.
Rachel, can you remind us again the level of the pathways?
Yes. Yep. So green is when you're regulated, you're connecting, you would see staff really engage with kids. Red is when things are starting to escalate. That's when you're like a zebra on the savanna. There's that movement involved. You're kind of getting stressed out. You're wanting to get out of a situation or do something about it. And then blue is that shutdown mode. Like, there's been enough stress to protect yourself. You're going to go into shutdown mode. And I appreciate you putting that in the chat, Kelly, because there isn't necessarily a right or wrong answer. Like, none of us can step inside these imaginary people's bodies and see where they're at. But what we're trying to do is think about, is there a reason why they aren't engaging with the kids? And certainly, there's probably some of you out there that are thinking, well, they just need to do their job and we need to go over, you know, what they're supposed to be doing every day. It's not okay that they're sitting on their phones, which is a conversation that, yes, we could have. But is there potentially other stuff going on for them? And we're going to go through an exercise shortly that I think will help kind of summarize all of this as well. Kathy says, I think red too, disengaged but not quite shut down. Yep. Yep. And again, there's no right or wrong answer, but just trying to see, is there potentially some other things going on? And is there flexibility in then how we respond? So when you're headed up to that group, what are you going to tell those staff people? How are you going to check in with them? And is there a place where you can come from a place of curiosity about where they might be at in terms of their stress as well? Okay, so for this one, I promised you we're going to read through a scenario. So I know most of you have your cameras off already, but for this, go ahead and just make yourselves comfortable. Turn your camera off. Yeah, thank you, Laura. You said, I can't imagine there's a great budget surplus remaining if a staff is completely engaged. That makes a lot of sense, right? There's not a lot of resources in their budget if they're not interacting with kids. So that's a really interesting comment. So keep that in mind, Laura, too, as we move through this next little exercise. So I'm going to read you a scenario that hopefully is fairly common in programming. And just as a quick reminder, I know Kelly just had me do this, but just in case, since we don't have it right on the slide, just remember that the green zone is where we're feeling hopeful and resourceful. This doesn't mean that worries don't arise in the green zone, but we're able to respond from a place of regulation. So as we turn into the red or the blue pathways, our body's telling us that in order to stay safe, it wants to either puff up like a blowfish or sink inside its shell like a turtle. So for this next exercise, pretend you're a college student who's working on a summer camp to save up for next year's rent. So as you envision the scenario, feel free, again, make yourself comfortable, take care of yourself, do what you need to do. But I want to encourage you, as you hear this, to pay attention to what comes up in your body and any signals of stress that you might experience. So notice those feelings, sensations, thoughts that might you have. Or actions that you really want to take in response to this. And I am going to look away and just read off of my script here that I created. So here we go. So again, you're a college student. You wake up in the morning, you're a bit tired from the previous day at camp, but you're energized to help a group of kids finish a board game that they've been creating during craft time. You pull yourself out of bed with ease. However, before you can make it out of your bedroom door, you hear your roommate and who's screaming at her boyfriend. They're screaming at each other. They're moving from room to room, slamming doors, and you're reluctant to go out in the hallway. So instead of going to take a shower, you throw on some deodorant, some fresh clothes, and you quickly make a break for the door, and you forget to grab breakfast. When you get to your car, you're out of breath, your heart is racing, you're in the red zone. But luckily, you have a nice commute, and you turn on some music as you drive through the glory of the Wisconsin woods on your way to camp. When you arrive at work, you're back in the green pathway, and you're quick enough to steal a snack from the stash that you have on site so that you can start your day with some energy. So you're ready to go, but then you realize that your co-counselor is running late and you're alone as parents start dropping kids off. And your co-lead usually takes attendance, and it seems like they have some secret code they use to mark when kids are coming in. So you're trying to figure out this code while you're trying to get all the kids as they're rushing at you, trying to decipher everything at once. And you start dipping a little bit closer to the red pathway. Then that dreaded parent arrives and is screaming at their son as they open the car door. And it's the kind of scene that gets every single camper's attention, and your heart just starts racing, not knowing if you're going to need to intervene or not. The parent closes the door, however, and the camper somehow miraculously joins their friends and transitions without any sort of scene. So you make a plan to check in with that camper later in the morning, and you feel yourself kind of coming back to that green pathway. But then you get a message on your walkie that there's been a complete change in the schedule. So rather than starting the day with a group check-in, you need to get everyone up to the pool for swim time ASAP. And even though there will be other lifeguards, you're not too happy about watching the group without your co-staff, because usually you divide the kids up and you have certain kids that you know their skill level better than other kids. So this stresses you out a bit. Your nervous system is kind of revving up here again. You're back in the red. So on top of everything, there's extra toys and floats in the pool that day, and the whole place is just louder and more chaotic than it normally is. You're on high alert. Your co-staff arrives just in time to transition the kids back to your assigned pavilion, and on the way, all of a sudden you feel completely depleted. You hang back at the end of the line, and you only make minimal verbal responses with the kids when they ask you a question. And when you get back to base camp, you linger a little longer than necessary getting the snack ready, and several students start arguing, and you just can't resist the urge to pull out your phone and check it as a quick escape. And of course, there's a message on your phone from your roommate from earlier in the morning asking for a call. So that is the end of scene there. So I used this scenario, I wrote it this way for a couple particular reasons. And one of them being, it's not particularly egregious by any means. There isn't something that's just something that would make the news or anything going on in this person's life. These are all pretty regular things that would happen for a staff member of this age coming into a summer camp, right? But it's a good representation of how even just those normal stressors throughout the day are enough to activate that nervous system. Again, our body's normal reaction, our normal response to stress. And you can see how even simple things like grabbing something to eat, playing some music, those are things that we then replenish our body budget, or it helps calm our nervous system. So there's easy, simple things that we can do and help staff members do in order to fill their bucket back up. And I only grazed on it, but I know Dr. Michaels did in her presentation as well, just that added piece of technology that we didn't have to deal with 20 years ago, but even just having that phone in pocket, having that constant connection to people who might be reaching out to you for help or things like that. That's something that we have to think about in the staff that we support in this day and age. And then I think it's a really easy opportunity to see, is there a purpose for those stress responses? Because when you hear screaming in your house, it's a normal reaction to get revved up so that you can get out of that situation. So this staff person's body told them, get out of that situation. It was protecting them. They did the right thing. Same with at the pool scene, when things are getting chaotic, the staff person is on high alert, which is what we would want them to be. We want them paying attention and making sure kids are safe and that everyone is where they need to be so that we don't have any incidents. But then how do we replenish their stress response or their body budget when they come out of that situation? Right. I'm curious to see any comments, any observations that you had in your own body budget when you were thinking about what it would be like to be that staff person? Anyone willing to share in the chat? You were stressed when you didn't have enough staff at the pool. Yep. And how did you know you were stressed out? Where did you feel it? Yeah, staff not calling in last minute, having to adjust. And Alex, thank you for putting that in here from that perspective, because a lot of what I have here is really trying to see it from staff's point of view, but that's also important, right? Because we're having to make decisions as leaders too, and then where is our body budget? How can we support our staff's body budget if we're also experiencing some of those stressors and having to recalibrate as we go throughout our day? It's a really good point to make. The day didn't go as planned. Yeah, that can really throw people off and take energy out of that budget, right? And that's an area where we have to then make deposits back in. Feeling anxious. And I can share with you too, I think I probably have a stronger reaction like reading it, but for me, I feel it in my body. I feel a little bit stressed out still after reading that, just in my chest. Like having been in similar situations, it's like in your chest, you might get some knots in your stomach. All of those are things that we want to have conversations with ourselves, with our staff, because if we can start to identify those things or think about what a certain scenario might feel like, then we're going to have some ideas on what we can do. So from here, I promise we're going to now regulate our systems a little bit. Yeah, thank you for sharing. There's people are saying like, this is kind of the nature of the beast. Like we kind of run on the edge or kind of run on low supply of energy daily because we're constantly having to problem solve. So this is where we really want to think about where we can strategically be making deposits and helping to regulate our nervous system for sure. There. So now that our nervous systems are a little activated, let's start to explore some practical ways we can stay nimble and ways that we can maybe flow back to that green regulated place. So if we had a bit more time or we were in person, I would probably walk you through like a guided practice. But since we don't, I'm going to take a shortcut and I'm going to share a couple personal visuals that help me to regulate. So I'm going to call these my visuals to a green pathway or my peaceful moments. And I want you, as I go through these and explain each of these visuals, to be thinking of some visuals that you can recall in your own mind or pull up pictures even on your own devices that help you to regulate. And also be thinking about how you might have a similar conversation or a similar brainstorming session with the teams that you work with so that you can all have these visuals in place as you start your summer camp. So you hopefully can see my blurry pictures here. In the first picture, that is our family pet, Mona. She's been through thick and thin with us, and that's her sitting, I think, on one of my legs. And whenever I even just recall her in my mind of her sitting on me, that's just an instantly grounding experience. Just feeling my safe little animal on lap is a grounding experience. The second picture is a picture of a flower that grew in our first garden that we grew last year. And I don't know if you can see it, but if you look really close, there's a bumblebee buzzing on there. And like, it just brings like warmth. And to me, this is just brings hope to mind. So if I'm in a stressful situation and I see or I envision something like this, that hopeful connection feeling comes back to mind. It's very regulating. And then that third picture is a picture of myself with my oldest daughter strapped on the front carrier when she was still tiny. We're just out in the sunshine, enjoying the day, the fresh air. And again, another example of how seeing this or almost like pretending I'm back in that space, it's so connecting and so grounding for me. There's just a glorious day. And so that feeling instantly comes back when I think about it. So if you take just a few moments to think about what are two or three peaceful moments or green pathway visuals you might have, I'm hoping that it also invokes that sense of safety and regulation and that you can already kind of feel your nervous system coming back to that green pathway. I think it's also helpful here to think about how powerful it might be if every single staff person had three of these visuals going into a stressful day. how every, like, if every camper also had this in mind, and these are tools that we could remind each other of, or that we could have on hand and pull out in times of stress, I just imagine that having a really powerful impact. So this is a really good segue into the next idea. So what we evoked in that last slide was a version of a glimmer. The glimmer is a concept that's, it's free, it takes no time, and it has a ton of power to help regulate your nervous system, and it adds to that body budget. So the idea is where a trigger, which I'm sure most of you have heard of, prompts you to go into survival mode, get away, run, fight, flee. A glimmer is something that provides security. So glimmers can be something concrete and physical, like a weighted blanket, a worry stone, a stress ball, or it can be a visual or a memory like we recalled in that last slide. So if everyone will participate, I'm going to give you all a moment to just think about a glimmer that might be powerful for yourself and that you're willing to share. And I'm going to have you type it in the chat, but wait to hit enter, because I'd like to, when I say go, have everyone hit enter all at once, and then we'll have a cascade of glimmers to pull some ideas from. So again, just take a moment to think about a glimmer that you have that helps you regulate, and then type it in the chat, and when I say go, we'll release it and share those with the whole group. All right, I hope I've given everyone enough time. I'm going to go ahead and say enter into the chat your glimmers. Yeah, so music, we're talking about closing eyes, taking a breath. Breath is in here several times. Even just some, like, I hear some really positive self-talk coming through. So remember, just take things one thing at a time. A stone from a student. So that's combining a different things, because it's a touchstone, but it's also a positive memory we have from one of the kids we worked with. These are great ideas. Fresh fallen snow. Brilliant. And the sunshine. And I think these things are also cool to do because you can see how many of them are related to nature, which is something I think summer camp has a lot of advantage in tapping into nature and helping to regulate staff and also kids that we're working with. And dance party, yes. Yes, movement. All right, so you guys did a great job of foreshadowing the next few slides. Just gotta get my slides on here. Here we go. So first, before we talk about how do we deal with like the stressful parts, I wanted to give you all a few really concrete ideas and how you promote that green pathway to begin with, and how you fill up and make sure you start each day with a full budget so that you're going in and you're regulated. So one of the ideas is to take the analogy that we've been talking about, this body budget, and literally write it out the same way you would your bank account. So take a day at camp and think about, as you go through certain activities, maybe you encounter different kids, think about what deposits are being made, what withdrawals are being made, and then what you want to do to kind of balance out that budget so that you've got a little bit of extra and you're not depleted. And taking time to do that and adjust that throughout the season, or doing that as an activity as a team with staff, can be really powerful because it's an opportunity for them to reflect, but then to also share that information so they can help watch out for each other throughout. Because if you had an idea, what are some common withdrawals or deposits that impact when you're co-staff, you can make sure you are helping to team and trade off with one another and help out in that way. I also have a playlist on here. I think Kelly, you mentioned a playlist. This is something Dr. Michaels talked about in her presentation too. And I think it's not a secret that music has a powerful impact on our nervous systems. The cool thing about using it here is you can be even more deliberate with it, because if you know that you're in the red pathway, you're amped up, you're wanting to flee, you can take something that will help you kind of get that movement out, something that's pumped up, something that gets you going, and then transition into a quieter song, transition from there, and help calm your nervous system down. Whereas if you're in a place where you're completely shut down, you can do the opposite and start off calm And then pick a song that gets you moving a little bit and then gets you a little more motivated. Really be strategic with it. Touchstones are something that people also mentioned in the chat. This can be a literal stone, like the picture, because stones are grounding. But it could be any object that helps calm you down. I know in one of the after school programs that I visited, there was a staff person that had this particular pen that she took attendance with. She wanted that certain pen. It just had the best texture when she wrote with it, and she loved it. It was comforting to her because as kids would come in and she would take attendance, if things were kind of amped up during that transition, she would also doodle to regulate herself. So it was just this really nice way to make sure that she was filling back up her bucket and starting off in a regulated place when kids were coming in during the day. And then create green path spaces. So we talk a lot in our WAN courses about using spaces to help guide behavior. And the same idea is applied here for staff, but it's really getting creative and thinking about how you can create spaces that really fill those buckets back up. So I think about like maybe each program focusing on like the break space for staff and making sure there's extra food or there's a place where they can really be quiet. Or there's some fun snacks or things like that, music playing, whatever it might be, or that that's a place that you all design together and knowing that that's a safe place anyone can go to take a break if they need to. These are all front-end things we can do and talk through and plan with staff to show that we really care about their well-being and we want them to be regulated in that green space, that we want to help them, and that again, goes back to that retention idea where we're keeping them safe. We want them to keep coming back for more, and that's how we're going to do it. But like we talked about, even in the best of best programs, there's going to be stressors that come up. So odds are either yourself, your staff, or your kids are going to end up in the red pathway at some point during the day. So again, this is when we're really puffed up. And when thinking about tools in this area, it's really helpful to think of the Hulk characters. That's why I've got this big visual of the Hulk here. Like the Hulk, if we're pumped up or we're in that red space where we're wanting to fight or flee, it's important to remember our intentions aren't necessarily bad. Just like the Hulk, we're still, in the end, we're still a good character. But there's not really any reasoning or thinking our way out of a situation when we're in that flight mode. We have to let that stress cycle play out, just like we talked about. We have to let that work through our bodies, let that cortisol or whatever that might be work through. And so we need to release that energy in a positive way. So here's some ideas on how we do that. One of them is just proactive stimming or movement is what that is. So that could be somebody wiggles their foot under the desk just to release that energy. And they do that on purpose if they know they're getting amped up. Or it could be even just giving yourself a hug and feeling that pressure on your body if you know that's regulating to your nervous system. So the idea here is to think about what helps you and have those conversations ahead of time, and so that when you get amped up, there's things that you can do in the moment. Another option is just to change the equation. So in summer camp, I think of sometimes just like the really hot, sticky, uncomfortable environments. Like, do you move to the shade? Do you separate the group into two to make the group smaller? Just simple things that you might already be doing, but when done for this specific purpose can be really powerful. Tapping is another one where you use your fingers to tap on certain parts, pressure points on your body, and that's very regulating. There's a bunch of YouTube videos out there that you can all look up. Hot and cold compressed is a similar idea because it activates that vagus nerve, which is that theory we talked about at the beginning that underlines all of this. So it just activates your nervous system in a way that calms it down. And I love that one because we often have an ice pack on hand or some ice in the cooler or whatever that might look like. So it's easy to grab and do without anyone being the wiser. Humming, singing, or gargling also has a really regulating effect on the nervous system because our vocal cords are directly linked to our nervous system. And so if things are really heightened at camp one day, that would be a good time to turn on the music or have the kids sing a song And the whole purpose might be, again, to help the staff person or a certain kid, but the whole group doesn't have to know. And that could be a part of our everyday activities, which is really nice. And then eye movement is another thing that you can do. And there's different activities you can look up, but it can also be as simple as sitting down in a quiet space to read something. And that eye movement is really effective in calming our nervous systems, because if you think of that zebra on the savanna, they're using their eyes to look left, they're using their eyes to look right. And again, it helps us to complete that stress cycle, just as if we were that wild animal running away from that danger. So all of these things are very simple. They don't take a lot of time at all, but they're really impactful and they can go a long way. And then if you find yourself or your staff in that blue pathway, which again is that shutdown mode, it's really helpful to think of this bear kind of slowly coming out of hibernation. I actually looked this up when I was planning this presentation, and it turns out bears can actually like very suddenly wake up if there's something that triggers them. But for the purpose of this analogy, we'll pretend that bears don't want to just like jolt out of their dens when they wake up in the spring. They want to gradually lift their heads and stretch and yawn and gradually wake themselves up. Same idea for us. Like if we're in shutdown mode, it doesn't make sense for us to jolt ourselves back into action, and we want to be gradual. So a lot of these are practices that Dr. Michaels hit on as well. But again, if used in a particular context, I think you can see the results really magnifying. So we've got different ideas for breathing, mindfulness, which is really about connecting the body and the brain again and getting those things to work together. And then some ideas for reconnecting. So under the reconnecting, we've got imagine a time or a person. It's like thinking about a scene that was really helpful for you, or a time you really had fun with the kids, anything to kind of get you back up and moving. Make small movements is literally what it says. It can be like shaking out your wrists, stretching, yawning, really gentle things to get you going. Simple yoga. The idea here isn't to be like doing backflips or back bends on the mat, but just simple stretches, breathing as you stretch, getting things slowly going. So another opportunity to reflect here at the end. How might you all get buy-in from staff to practice and utilize some of these strategies? Does your program support open conversations around stress and triggers? How do you talk about self-care? And then what's one thing you plan to change after considering this information? And feel free to use the chat. I'm especially curious to see if you have any ideas how you might get staff to buy into some of this, or one thing you plan to change. So we'll just give you a moment to think about these questions here. Yeah, so I'm seeing a couple of things come in here. And one of them is talking about doing this on the front end. So really having an honest conversation when you're in training so that you can all start the season off with a plan in place. And give people opportunities to practice it. I know some of the stuff I threw out there and the ideas you have, it might seem a little awkward because people aren't, as funny as it sounds, like people aren't even trained at breathing anymore, right? Like we have to retrain ourselves to breathe. We have to retrain ourselves to move our bodies in ways that are helpful for us. So it seems kind of awkward. And so just practicing and making it fun can really go a long way in convincing people and normalizing it. Because again, the point of this presentation is to say, like, this is normal reaction. We all have stress. So let's be honest about it and let's figure out what helps us. Great. All right. Well, I think I'm actually over time here. So I'm going to just zip to my last slide here and just end on a funny note. So, of course, I had to add in another cat. This funny cat here is saying, do you mean to tell me that a stress ball isn't for throwing at people who stress you out? And I think this fits in nicely because it's all about, right, like we want to do these things on purpose and have a plan in place. So a stress ball could be used the wrong way, but if you have a plan in place for it, it can go a long way in helping your staff. All right. think that takes us to the end.
Awesome. Well, thank you, Rachel. That was lovely. Thank you so much. I just all of a sudden, like, I have a whole bunch of ideas that I would be excited to use, and thinking about how the kids and the staff could do it all. But I want to throw in, you know, back out to our group right here for some Q&A. We have about 10 minutes before we take a break to do some great questions for Rachel. You could throw them in the chat, or Rachel, are you okay with people coming off of mute to ask those questions?
Of course.
Now, this is the time to ask some great questions so that we can, you know, if you're starting to think about, like, you know, how can you use this with staff? How can you use this with kids? How can you combine it? You know, is there, if you're doing this all together, like, should you talk with parents? I don't know. What do we want to ask Rachel while we have her?
Just as we're waiting here, Kelly, I see another comment here in the chat. Laura says, don't introduce in the weekly staff meeting because it's a stressful time of year. So not even waiting to summer camp, which I love, using it now. And I think that's a really good point of making this a part of our regular conversations. And that's a way to systemically do some change around this and model these practices. Because if you make it a part of every conversation you're having with staff, then that, again, that normalizes it and makes it okay for staff to come and have these conversations with you and demonstrate that you're open to getting creative and being thoughtful about how we manage stress in the moment.
Your comment about the red pathway and how to, you know, kind of regulate in that space. So the stimming and what, you know, sometimes it's the physical touch and things. I think about some options that you give staff and kids, right? It doesn't have to be just for the kiddos. But I think about, like, a sensory bag and, you know, kind of as you get to know kids, what will help to regulate them, and also the same thing for staff. You know, I think about the wiggle seats with the bumps on it, so kids can, you know, rock back and forth, and that is great to be able, and it's not doing any harm, but it's giving them what they need to bring them back. I also am reminded of one particular kiddo who just, you know, he knew when he was getting to a certain point, and the staff would do this with him because they're like, because you're also getting me to this point. We would just have them roll down the hallway of the school we were at. So then I think about day camp and I think, oh, their kids love doing things like rolling down the hill, right? Or like race with your staff. And that could be enough for those staff and kids to be able to rate. I mean, if it's the right thing, but is there anybody out there that has any thoughts about that too? Like what else they have done where it's like, oh, that is just such a simple, quick thing that, you know, you don't need a bunch of materials to, you know, buy and spend a whole bunch of money on, but some things that can really just regulate and bring the staff kids back to, you know, that green happy zone.
I want to see if anyone has some other ideas, but I think you bring up such a good point, Kelly, and that's part of what we're talking about here too, is I think it's easier to say, oh, this will work for kids, or convince ourselves it's okay to use for kids, but for some reason it's not okay for ourselves. And that's what we want to get across here, is like, we all have a stress response, all of us. And so all of those basic things help out all of us. So a kid doesn't need to know when you grab something out of the combing bin that that's for yourself too, but you can go ahead and use it. I know when I supervised in child welfare, our desks always had a basket full of fidgets and things like that. You might think we were in a childhood classroom, but it was for the adults coming into the space. We were talking about tough things, and that helped them to regulate. And so why not? Oh, as Kelly throws her out, I have my skill that I've been playing with the whole time as I'm talking to all of you. So just to demonstrate that these things really are helpful. Finding favorite places in camp that's a safe space to get a moment you need. Absolutely. And I think that can be challenging because it can feel like people are on you all the time. Those kids have a lot of needs. But even if it's just like, I'm going to put my back against this particular tree that's out of the sun and take a breath, that can go a long ways, and it's doable. We'll keep throwing some ideas in there. I think we are at our break now.
According to my schedule, we have until 9:40. So we have about 9 more minutes if we started a little bit early. So again, now is a really good time. So if there's, again, anything that you have done that works for your staff, or if there's anything that hasn't worked, maybe even just say like, I thought it was going to work and it didn't. It went the wrong way. That's totally okay. All right. Well, hearing nothing in the chat, nobody coming off of mute. So thank you so much, Rachel, you're not Rochelle, you're Rachel. Thanks, Rachel, so much for this presentation this morning. I know I took a lot of notes, and I'm thinking about that body budget, and I think is a great way to frame it. And, you know, what can you do for, you know, visuals to get back to that green pathway? And I think about the Hulk and making that point that the Hulk is not a bad guy, like he also a good, you know, but you feel all pumped up and thinking about like everybody being able to like look at that visual, since I know I'm a visual person, and that'd be like, oh yeah, you're all puffed up, so I need to get back to like a soft, calm cat, you know, reaction. So but thank you so much, Rachel, you are amazing. So right now we will have a break until 9:50. I know it's a little bit longer, but I'll give you time to get more coffee, tea, whatever, use the restroom, all that good stuff. But we'll start at 9:50. We will be coming back to you here with Planning Resources for Wellness with Dr. Scoville. She'll be going through some coaching tools and other toolkits for mental health, wellness planning, and all kind of dimensions of wellness, and working with a diverse group of staff as well to kind of target everybody else, to target everyone's needs. So, hearing nothing else for Rachel, we'll see you back here at 9:50. Thanks for being here.